Assalamu alaikum, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to welcome you to the launch of the report of IHRC with regards to the anti-Muslim hatred that's been generated and the report entitled Environment of Hate. It is rather unfortunate that we at IHRC have found ourselves writing another report on the situation for Muslims in the UK. This is something that has been going on for quite some time. It's decades old, and we find ourselves every few years having to look at what the situation is, how the things are moving, and the kind of direction and the direction of travel within the UK is also interesting, and I'm sure Arzu Merali will be talking about some of the findings that we've actually got. I think it's safe to say that everyday life for Muslims in Britain is characterized by rising levels of abuse, discrimination, and violence. And the report, which is the latest in a series by IHRC, as you learn, seeks to evaluate Muslim experiences of hostility and discrimination. And it does paint a very disturbing picture of a community under siege from the prevailing winds of racial and religious bigotry. And one of the things that we want to try and do is open up the space for discussion about the kind of things that are actually going on. We want to try and make sure that there is going to be space afterwards, and obviously at the end of this launch, and also after Arzu has actually spoken, to ask some questions regarding the report itself. And there will be, we've got a distinguished panel of guests who are going to be speaking around some of the issues in which they are experts in, and I'll be introducing those guests as we go through and introduce them to speak at various points. I would like to also say that it is important for us to actually try and make sure that we pick up and the messages that are going to be coming out, and this report isn't just an academic exercise to try and just somehow say these are the things that are going on. IHRC is a campaigning organisation, and our view is to make sure that we do the research, and the research that is being done, the academic work that is being done, it is then going to actually be used to make a difference in society. It is to hold the mirror up to this society, the establishment here in the UK, and to actually say what the problems are that are going on and what the potential solutions are also going to be. And both of these things together are going to be things that are going to be making a difference going forward, because our purpose at IHRC is to make sure that we make the UK a much better place for all to live in, and what we don't want to do is marginalize one section of the community, and this report is actually going to be talking about that. I would now like to introduce Arzu Merali, who is one of the authors of the report. She's a writer and researcher born and based in London, UK. She focuses on human rights, Islamic feminism, decoloniality, and the grammars of human dignity. She's one of the founders of Islamic Human Rights Commission, and formerly an editor of the web journal Palestine Internationalist. So, Arzu Merali.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Thank you everyone for coming this morning. There's been a lot of difficulty on the trains and everything. So I was wondering last night where to begin, and I thought it might be useful if I gave you an idea of where IHRC started from, to see how the long journey has been for this particular study. So we started out 18 years ago, as I said, I'm one of the founders. And essentially most of our work focused outside of the UK. So I myself came from projects, FreeSexEarchy, which was to do with Nigeria, and Free Sheikh Obeid, which was to do with Sheikh Obeid held in Israeli detention, as well as War Crimes Watch, which was looking at war crimes in the former Yugoslavia. there were other colleagues who had specialisation in Southeast Asia, Bosnia, North Africa, etc. We all came together to set up IHRC. And it was a hectic time. We were all coming together with different specialisations and working on the things we knew about, and in some ways it was rather ad hoc. But what we found very quickly was that we would be getting phone calls or emails or, in those days, faxes and letters saying things like, well, you know, I'm really glad that you're working on issues like sexual harassment and bans on hijab in France and Turkey. Do you know that happened to me here? Or somebody saying something like, well, you know, my parents are doctors, I'm predicting A's in all my A-levels, but my head of year has, in those days, on my UCA form, I don't know what it's called these days, UCAS or whatever, said that I shouldn't do medicine because I'll probably get married a little bit early and leave. So basically all my future screwed up. We have people coming to us and saying they've been banned from seeing their children on family court because they took their child to a Saturday school to their family. This is in 1997, 1998, okay? So it's before all the heady days of what we now think is the post-9/11 world, post-7/7, post-Libya, etc. It was a wake-up call to people like me, born and brought up here in the 70s and 80s. We thought, well, if we didn't see the end of racism, that maybe it had abated. It clearly wasn't. It was clearly back. We just basically got mobile and tried to run away from it. And we were now having to confront it. And so, really, by the time we launched our first study on Islamophobia in the UK, which was the year 2000, probably half of our work was UK-focused. I'm not sure what the figure is now, but as you'll see from our website, things that are happening here and are happening now are of huge concern to us. And those of us who are there from the beginning and those of us who joined see what's happening here is not just about what's happening here, but it's having repercussions elsewhere. If you want to see all our other work, we've got over a decade's worth of studies. Please do go to our website. You know, you can get the links from my colleagues here as well. But to the actual details of this report, I'm just going to give a very quick overview of our chapters. Chapter 5, which is an odd place to start, but anyway, that's the one that deals with our survey findings. We surveyed just shy of 1,800 people in 2014 in the UK. We tried as much as possible to be representative across the different cities of the UK where Muslims are largely based. And the details of the demographics, etc., are all there for you to see. Some of the key things that we found in terms of experiences. Well, violent attacks were up. They were up from nearly 14% in 2010 when we did the study the first time round, up to nearly 18% this time round. It's an upward rise. It doesn't seem much, but then when you go away and actually review the type of cases that are being reported, you start seeing levels of violence and patterns of violence that are really quite alarming. Attacks on Muslim women in particular, very symbolic attacks on people dressed in a supposedly Muslim way, as well as people who are mistaken to be Muslim because of their ethnicity. We saw discrimination at work and discrimination at school, the reports of that doubling. Okay. In 2010, about 60% of the people we asked questions of said they had seen something demonising or stereotypical about Muslims in the media. That's now 93%. That's staggering. Only 7% of people said they hadn't seen anything. More than half of the people we surveyed said they felt that government policies, and we look into this in more detail, I'll go into it in a second, are creating that negative climate and affecting their quality of life on a daily basis. Nearly 60% of people said they had been suspected or wrongly accused of doing something, viewed with suspicion. And nearly 80% of people said that they had witnessed Islamophobia against another person. We have an executive summary. I'm sure you can pick it up at the stall at the back. You can download it from our website. But it's not a happy picture. And it's a picture that we feel is clearly something that has gotten worse. What we argue, we look at... Excuse me, when I get my executive summary up in front of me. Is that... We are living in a kind of myth of a post-racial society. We're not the people who came up with this, many people have discussed this. But until we stop ignoring structural racism, whether it's Islamophobia or any other form of racism or prejudice, we're not going to do more than really just scratch the surface of this issue. Part of the shift in culture that is creating more problems we've seen in the last 5 years or so go around the individualization of society, where we're seeing the responsibilities of government being shunted out to civil society organizations. You can see in the dramatic rise and fall of kids camping an example of this. You're seeing things that government should do being made the responsibility of civil society as part of that discourse. So we've gone back and we've looked at historical instances, whether it's to do with various riots, etc., of the last 30 years. You start getting the cyclical argument that it's the communities themselves who are backward. You know, everything is a level playing field, and if you're not doing well, it's your own fault, okay, and it's up to you to change that situation. Once you're in that mode, things start becoming really anti-democratic, and you go into this in a lot of detail. Once you have established the idea in the social imagination that communities are responsible for themselves, and that government institutions in particular don't bear responsibility for the way they're being treated, you can end up enacting laws that treat people differently. And we have that now. We've had that with anti-terrorism legislation for a long time. We've had it now with the enactment of what was a policy that has prevented for the last 10 years until CTS this year. But we're also seeing it in things like the Trojan horse and hoax palaver of last year, or the scandal, I should say, and many other examples. We also argue that militarization of society is something that's very much helped by the environment of hate, which is what we call the report. The fact that we can are increasingly seeing demonization of people to such an extent, whether they're here or there, that we feel we must be more aggressive militarily, okay? And that militarization is something that doesn't impact simply Muslims, it's impacting the whole of society. And then, of course, we talk about grassroots backlash, etc. We go into a lot of detail, and I don't want to take up too much time because there are plenty of other people who can talk in detail about this. About the way political discourse and media discourse don't help. They're not necessarily taking the same trajectories, but they help each other very distinctly in creating this vicious cycle, which Muslims can't break out of. We keep hearing the argument, well, if only Muslims condemned, if only Muslims did this, if only Muslims showed themselves to be distinct. There are only 3 million Muslims in this country. That's about the leadership of the sun. You know, we can't, you know, even if we befriended, each one was befriended a sun leader, it wouldn't be enough to prove who we are. It's about the institutions being responsible and saying, this is how society needs to work. These are what the ethics of society are. We deal with the love around British values. I'm sure there'll be questions about that later. And we talk about prevent and the socialization of hatred that's come about. For 10 years of this policy and now this law, the CTS, we make several recommendations. I think I've run short on time, so we can elaborate later. And of course, general education and awareness campaigns are something that we talk about a lot. We suggest Muslims do that and continue doing that, and I think that's the key thing, to continue doing that. But they should do that because that's just a good thing to do. It's not the responsibility, ultimately, of every Muslim as an individual or every Muslim organisation to solve this problem. In fact, they can't. We don't have power. This is ultimately about finding partnerships with the institutions who do and for them to take responsibility. We've looked at the whole discussions around media regulatory standards. I don't need to go over them here. We do need organisations and civil society to denounce more the type of aggressive discourses that Muslims, but not just Muslims, are facing. You know, whether it's so-called benefits cheats, whether it's so-called black communities, whether it's so-called Muslim communities, the list is endless. We are in a cycle of scapegoating and demonisation that is crushing the society that we live in. We've asked for an end to the double standards in the treatment of issues relating to Islamophobia, sexism, prejudice and racism. There are plenty of examples of that week in, week out. We're looking to academic institutions as well to put their lot in behind this, as well as really for communities to build stronger relationships. We are all easily getting pigeonholed into discussions about Islamophobia, discussions about, like, working class marginalisation, about this, about that, about the other. yes, we have our peculiarities and we have our differences, but the social problems that we are facing are all coming from the same root. And unless we're going to really focus on where that problem is, we're always endlessly going to be fighting not just our own little struggles, but actually ultimately against each other without fixing the real problem. I think I'll leave it there. If you have questions, you can open the floor later. Thank you.
I would now like to ask, open the floor up to get people to ask any questions that they've got with regards to the report, with regards to what Arzu has said, before we invite our other speakers to speak on the subject. Roshan?
I just wanted to ask panelists whether they think that Islamophobia and racism are the same thing, or they're two different things. Because often Islamophobes will say, that we're not being racist when we're having a go at you as Muslims, because Islam is a faith, it's not a race.
Do you hear that?
This question at the back, can you take it back?
Hello, I live in HA9, which is the address you've got on the front of your publication. And two horrible things happened yesterday. My neighbour, who wears a hijab, was not served in a shop. The reaction of the people who lived in our block was, we'll all walk to the shop and shout out, Islamophobia here. This caused the man who owned the shop to say he made a mistake. Okay, he made a mistake. Which I don't believe for one second. And another incident happened. Another friend of mine in Brixton, she went onto a bus and was spat at. So if anybody says there's no Islamophobia, they're talking rubbish. And from my side of the pond, because I stick up for any form of prejudice, I am called a self-hating Jew. Because I say that fight for Palestine, I am a self-hating Jew. So anybody who sticks up for any racial discrimination gets a nasty label. This is really unjust, and I think it's been getting worse.
But one more question before I open up to the panel. Just over here, please, at the front.
Arzu mentioned that the Muslim community needs to take power and work with some of the key stakeholders in order to challenge Islamophobia. But to what extent could you argue that the Muslim community retreats into a victim mentality and is sitting back and waiting for other people to help? To what extent do they have a responsibility to be proactive and to challenge that themselves? And if so, what can they do around that?
Arzu, if you want to take that question first.
I think I'll sort of combine the responsibility of response to you, because yes, we're from HA9, it's Wembley, and I think for me, when you see that type of thing happen in an area like Wembley, which is so, for want of a better word, an old-fashioned world, multicultural, where, you know, people generally don't really care that much about who or where anyone is from, it, I think for me, highlights the kind of state of affairs that we're in. It's very, very alarming that that kind of negativity could be internalised in an area like Wembley. And that brings me to your point about the responsibility of Muslims. See, for me, and I think organisationally, we feel that ultimately it's not about oppressed communities having to do anything. Okay? It's not their lot in life that they have to somehow make it better themselves. Either we live in a just, fair society, or we are trying to aspire for one. Okay, and that means the power of society, and the power of society comes from the institutions ultimately. The culture is created by those institutions, has to change. Okay? In my lifetime, there's been a huge shift in culture, okay, in issues of sexuality, to a certain extent on anti-Semitism, and to an even lesser extent on some issues of racism, although as this report argues, and various reports argue, we feel old-fashioned, if you want a better phrase, biological racism is coming back, off of the back of Islamophobia. Yes, Muslims should do lots of things. They should be very interactive, this, that, and the other, because, you know, it's a good thing to do, but they don't have to. And I don't want to particularly be in a position where I'm recommending the Muslim community should do X, Y, and Z, A, because I don't think it'll have any serious impact, and B, because it's not their job to do so. By all means, you know, steam ahead, open the doors to the mosques, etc., if you want to, or be like me and be a kind of miserable misanthrope, right? Just sit at home and just grumble about the weather. But that's what that's your right to do. Islamophobia and racism,
does
somebody else want to
take that? Can I just introduce David? David Miller is a professor of sociology in the Department of Social and Policy Sciences at the University of Bath. From 2013 to 2016, he was RC UK Global Uncertainties Leadership Fellow, leading a project on understanding and explaining terrorism expertise in practice.
So just on the question of racism, well, yeah, of course Islamophobia is a form of racism, just like anti-Semitism is a form of racism. And when racists say, oh, well, Muslims aren't a race, you say, well, there's no such thing as race. There is one human race. Race is created by racists. And racists create races however they want to create them. If it's the hats that Jews wear, or the hats that Muslims wear, or the beards that people have, or all the strange food that they use, or all those kinds of things, those are all ways to racialize people, to make them into a race, so they can be discriminated against. And that's what we're seeing. We're not seeing discrimination against people who have particular politics, against the scary Islamists. We're seeing discrimination against Muslims because they're Muslims. And that's just racism.
Okay. Sorry, if I can just introduce you. Nisha Kapoor is a lecturer in sociology at the University of York and a visiting fellow at the Centre for Race, Ethnicity and Gender in the Social Sciences at Duke University. Just leave it there.
Just to follow up on David's point, I think it's really important to realise that Islamophobia is a form of racism, and it's not the only form of racism, but it's a significant form, and it's currently, you know, one of the most extreme. But the point about thinking about racism is not just that we can then label any kind of prejudice or nasty behaviour as then racism, which we might otherwise call bullying or something, but just that it has to link to a kind of structural arrangement that Arzu's talked about in terms of who is positioned where and what the consequences of that are. And in the current climate and in the current environment, the way in which Muslims are being positioned as kind of lesser citizens, being dehumanized in the media and sort of in politics, being held responsible for multiple things that have nothing, you know, that are not the responsibility of all Muslims, just in the way that if a terrorist attack happens by a kind of white far-right extremist, or white people aren't asked to condemn that atrocity, you know, it doesn't happen when it concerns sort of some sort of Islamic extremism. And it's to do with the positioning of that group of people structurally within society, which makes it operate in the way that racism has done since kind of modern times.
If I can just introduce Peter. Peter Oborne is a former chief political commentator of the Telegraph. He writes a weekly column for Middle East Eye and the Daily Mail.
There's two questions which I'll try and address. The first one is this issue, is Islamophobia racism? I'm not an academic, and I don't therefore want to engage with the very learned people on my left, because they know more about the theory of it. But it seems to me there's no question that Islamophobia exists, and I think this is one of the really important reasons for this. This is the most important reason for this report, and I think it's greatly understated, and I think attempts to deny it are bizarre, and it's very poorly understood in British society and by British politicians and in the British media, which of course, as this book shows, perpetrates it. Whether or not it's racism, there's no question it is used as a form of racism, because racism is illegal. I think this is a point. It's illegal to insult black people or Jews or so forth, or Chinese on the basis of their racial characteristics. It is not illegal to insult religion. That's a very important part of the British traditions of free speech, and there are very good and interesting reasons for it. But what is, and I think it is a free speech issue, that you can criticise religions. However, what is clearly happening, so I think I differ slightly from the panellists, clearly happening that it is that sort of exemption, as it were, is being used, virulently used, as a way of attacking a community. And I don't know what the solution is, because it is hard to see how you solve it in law, because I do believe you can criticize Christians or Buddhists or whoever it may be, or Muslims because of their religion. But I can see very clearly that the criticisms of Islam is a form of racism and is a form of pillaring a particular society. I don't know the solution.
That's great. Thank you for that. If there are any other questions that people want to ask before we move on to the next stage, if you can say where you're from, I should have said that for the previous round of questions, where you're from and what your question is. If you could just stand up and speak, because apparently the mic's
not I want to know about the process of addressing the complaints against Islamophobia. Are they well received and processed or not?
I didn't really catch that. Can you set out the question again?
What is the process of addressing the complaints? Yeah. Was the question that was actually asked? And how do you go about processing those complaints and so on? Arzu, can you answer to that?
So people who are responding to our open-ended questionnaires did so anonymously, so they were not, in that sense, reporting cases to us. But one of the questions we did ask, and I don't know, the PowerPoint doesn't seem to be running, but it's there if we can get it going again, is we asked people if they did complain, and if they didn't, is it because of X, Y, Z reasons? And we found that a lot of people were saying that they didn't complain. I don't have the book in front of me, which is a little bit silly, but the figure is there somewhere. And when we asked people to explain why in the open-ended questions, if we could get that running, you'll see them as they come across. That's really quite sad. I was actually feeling heartbroken. I'm quite a sort of cynical person, to sort of read people say things like, well, who's there to complain to? Or I didn't complain because of fear of repercussions. This is not a new phenomenon. This is something that many of us have studied and remarked upon for many, many years, decades even. It's not specific just to Muslims. But certainly this time around, that feeling came across more strongly. In the past, when people have spoken their open-ended questions, they've often been more optimistic about the future. And this time around, it was significant that we found that people were less inclined to complain, to see that there would be a way out of this. It's not that people didn't know there were complaints procedures, or that they could go to the police, or whatever the relevant way of complaining would be for whatever they'd experienced. It just was the fact of not feeling hopeful, or actually being scared to do so. So, yes, the figure this time is nearly half of the people said that they didn't complain because they didn't think anybody cared or that they would face repercussions. So I didn't really glance at some of the stupid.
One of the other, I think it's an absolutely crucial point. I think that the cases are very poorly collected by the authorities. I recently had a conversation with somebody, a group of people, who said, do you know, we complained, we spent half our days in the police station, because it was so prevalent. To talk to a lady in Cardiff who was terrified to leave her door and go to work, and she knew that she would get attacked or abused, and if she then went to the police station, she'd be spending several hours a day, or, you know, half her time complaining, and that was another reason.
Ian Law is here from Leeds, and one of his studies is quoted quite extensively in here. And what we tend to find is that when we do hear about cases, they're on the extreme end of things. But we tend to miss the everyday experiences like the ones that we were just saying, which are not really getting heard, this kind of slow drip. Whether it's verbal, whether it's just the atmosphere, or whether it's actual attacks that characterise the lives of many of our communities, not just Muslim communities in this country, and we really do need to start opening our minds.
One more question. If you'd like to stand up, if you don't mind, and just say where you're from, which organisation.
My name is Anne Gray. I'm a volunteer with the Campaign Against Criminalising Communities, and also an activist in the Green Party.
I have one comment and one question. The comment is basically about the fact that discrimination according to religion is illegal in employment issues. And I think that's something we should be addressing very seriously, because it will increase as the mood after the Paris attacks worsens. And it becomes a vicious circle, because the less Muslims are represented in the press, in public administration and so forth, the less they are able, or the less we are able to defend ourselves against this kind of attack and the institutional forces that have been referred to. The second is a question about prevent. I mean, I've been to so many meetings in the last few weeks, run by the National Union of Students, by the Right to Protest campaign, by CAMPAC itself, etc., about what do we do about prevent. Now, I think there are two strategies about how to deal with prevent, and I welcome the views of this audience about how we choose between those strategies and how we advance them. The academic world, the students and the lecturers, seem to be saying just resist, 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 don't implement it. Other people within local government, notably a Green councillor, Caroline Russell, in Islington, where this awful incident about the guy mentioning eco-terrorism in his French class took place, are saying, you know, let's try to bend the government's ear and bend the ear of the local government's officials and other councillors to try to implement prevent in a collaborative way, and to get community groups, and in particular faith groups, on board and try to basically educate the administration about the realities of Islam, and try to overcome some of the excesses that have been seen in that incident and many others. And I think maybe it will be helpful to reflect on that a little today. Thank you.
Thanks for that. Well, obviously I'm at a university called the University of Bath, and we have a policy like every other university in the country now on prevent. The union has been negotiating with management over this, and some of the more ridiculous stuff that's been in there has been taken out of the policy. But the policy is still, in the view of the union, in my view, disproportionate. You will recall probably that the law, the counter-terrorism security bill, proposed that prevent duty be imposed, and then there was a challenge in the process of reviewing the bill before it became law, which added in, of course, the universities, not further education, but higher education only, the universities also have a duty to defend academic freedom in the law, and that therefore the university implementation of prevent must be proportionate. We don't have that protection in further education, in the NHS, social care, in all the other places, and in the way we have that, we have something much, much better to cling on to in higher education, and that's the thing which needs to be clung on to. We've insisted that the university writes into its prevent policy a positive duty to defend academic freedom, defend the right to research terrorism, and to look at terrorist materials on the internet, and I hope that that's going to be done everywhere. The question you raised about training in particular, it seems to me that what we're going to find is that our university claims that the prevent coordinator of the Southwest is going to deliver all training to our university. Right? That's manifestly ridiculous. Of course, that person cannot do it. And what will happen, and we've had this confirmed yesterday, is that they will contract it out to online providers or to dodgy think tanks like the Henry Jackson Society. And I've noticed Hannah Stewart from the Henry Jackson Society sitting next to you. She may be able to tell us about their involvement later. Who will effectively be schooling people on Islamophobia and providing training on prevent, which is Islamophobic. And so the difficulty is what you do about that. Now, one solution is that union branches, and this could be done in other places as well, should also insist on a training about Islamophobia, anti-racist training, as well, at the same time as the prevent training. Our universities, so we know where we're at, but that will be negotiated, and so there's a possibility of doing that. The other thing, of course, is that some of the policies are ridiculous. The whole policy is ridiculous. But the guidance issued to the universities has preposterous stuff in it which cannot possibly be justified in the law. So stuff like, you can't have gender segregated events on campus. Well, our university has gender segregated events every day of the year because we have lots of people who do sports. That's easily challengeable. That kind of thing, and the guidance, not in the law, it seems to be, I'm not sure the exact relationship, that can be challenged. Some of the stuff in there about people must not be allowed to express views which overlap with those of terrorists. Well, if you look at the views of terrorists, some of them say things like we want to establish democratic control of our society, etc. Those kinds of things are clearly also overlapping with what's described in the Act as British values. So there's a whole series of stuff there that can be challenged at a legal level, and of course that must be done as well. The difficulty in higher education resisting this is that we cannot have a dispute at a national level. This has to be at a local level. That will lead to partial performance. The universities will then be able to double pay, and in theory, withhold all pay. So getting into a dispute over that is going to be tricky. It might happen, but so it seems to me that the better way to resist it, rather than a blanket boycott of it, which probably won't make any difference anyhow, is to actually systematically challenge the policies that are put in place by the universities.
No, I don't really have anything interesting to say.
A couple of things. The law on religious discrimination in employment, and my colleague Arvind will deal with it in detail, but it's, you know, used to say it was great on paper, but there are practical difficulties with this being accessed. Arvind will go into more detail. We've talked a lot about prevent in this, and there are practical responses against, again, I think Arvind will look at that. The actual impact of the idea of prevent has to be something that we look at as a long-term strategy to overcome. Okay, because even, let's imagine that it's all going to be repealed tomorrow, we're going to still be lumbered with the culture of it. And it's taken, you know, it's 10 years of us residents to research. We live in a kind of stars of state now. Definitely Muslims know it. The rest of us maybe just need to wake up to it. Prevent is the socialisation of hate now. It really has crept into the fibre of the way society operates, and unpicking that is going to be more than just a legal process, or even just a process for activists.
I think the main thing does need to be that we need to challenge and push back. Trying to educate the authorities, well, who's going to do that? The government is putting a lot of money in RAP and other training. Who's going to be giving the sort of training at the opposite end to actually educate these authorities? The government's going to put money into it. So that's going to be quite difficult to actually do. So I guess the only thing we really have is to resist and push back as hard as possible. But as Arzu has just identified, the culture of prevent is going to remain. So how do we deal with that? So there has to be a long-term plan amongst communities in terms of how we educate people, how we show people that prevent is underpinned by racist assumptions, that prevent itself is problematic, that what it's trying to achieve is problematic because it's demonizing and criminalizing the whole community. And we need to find ways of, not just the council, but in terms of those who are implementing it within the NHS, within the educational sphere, we need to find ways of getting it out to them in the most effective way possible.
Okay, I would like to move on to the next stage. There will be another round of questions and answers after this, but I would now like to ask Peter Oborne to say a few words in terms of what's happened, in terms of what's going on, and just reintroduce and add to what I said earlier. As we said, he's a former chief political commentator for the Telegraph. He has written a number of books identifying the power structures that lurk behind political discourse, including the triumph of the political class and the rise of political lying. He appears on BBC programmes, Any Questions and Question Time, and often presents Week in Westminster. He was voted Economist of the Year at the Press Awards in 2013.
Well, I don't really have a lot to say. I haven't yet read this book. It's terribly important, though, because, as I was saying just now, I have no doubt at all that Islamophobia is a really big problem in Britain and elsewhere. And it's something which, as citizens, we need to address. There was a question earlier on, which we didn't answer properly, which is, is it something for them, just Muslims to confront, or is it something for all of us to confront? And there's no question in my mind that it's for all of us, wider society, to confront. Islamophobia is part of a pattern. You can see at various times groups being marginalised, singled out in invidious ways by wider society. At different times that has happened to Jews, it's happened to homosexuals. Currently in Britain, the victim of choice is the Muslim. I haven't read this book, but I'm going to read it very carefully. I'll write about it, it's very important that its message it gets out there that there is a structural problem, and that the and that. In Britain, we keep on hearing from the Prime Minister and the Home Secretary and the official state apparatus about British values. No question to my mind what they are either. It's tolerance, decency, freedom. And I always think that the greatest thing of all about being British is that we stand up for the underdog. That's what we've always done. And it revolts me sometimes seeing things written, very ignorant things by very learned and important people with great influence about Islam. I mean, the use of the word Islamist in a particularly ignorant way, the use of the word extremist to really signify something we don't like. The use of the word moderate as a form of praise. That's why I've come along today. I look forward to reading this. I believe that this is a great subject, and all the more important to understand it in the light of the terrible events of the weekend. And in the weeks preceding it, across the world and in the Middle East, these are grave issues which we as a society must understand. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Peter, for your words. And I would. There will be an opportunity for people to ask questions after Nisha and David have also spoken. Nisha, if I can remind people, is a lecturer in sociology at the University of York and a visiting fellow at the Centre for Race, Ethnicity and Gender. In 2012-13, she was a Samuel Dubois Cook postdoctoral fellow at RAGSS and has previously held research posts at Manchester Metropolitan University and the University of Manchester.
Okay, thanks for the invitation today. I'm just going to say a few words to follow Peter. The report is incredibly important, if also quite disconcerting, in terms of its indication of the rise of Islamophobia in the UK continuing, as we've seen over the last 15 years and before. The vilification of Muslim communities, attacks on people in public places, at work, in school, are symptomatic of much broader structural trends which characterize by increasing securitization, a drastic reduction in equality and human rights, and a hollowing out of democratic principles and processes, which are all things that Arzu kind of referred to earlier. But in the brief kind of points that I want to make, I really just want to pick up on criminalization and how significant this is in the current moment, and as a way of thinking about the sort of the anti-democratization that's taking place. So, one of the most effective strategies used for sustaining racism, racial hierarchies and structures, is to criminalize a population. Campaigners who have fought for the abolition of prisons in the US point to the very connections between the birth of the prison system and the official ending of slavery, noting the continuing disenfranchisement of African Americans and other people of color through imprisonment. 70% of the US population, 70% of the US population is non-white. But disproportionality ratios are bigger and starker in Britain. So while the black population in Britain constitutes less than 3% of the total, they make up 13% of the prison population. And similarly, while Muslims make up just about 4% of the British population, of the total population in the country, they constitute 13% of the prison population. Political and media representations which present all Muslims as suspect are institutionalized through programs like Prevent and Channel, relying as they do on preemptive or preventative policing, as the report highlights, the most innocent or democratic acts, such as protesting the Israeli occupation of Palestine, become grounds for referral to the police. These programs criminalize on the basis of suspicion, which is usually based on racial or religious profiling, and relatedly, any indicator of political dissent against Western foreign policy or any expression of upset or opposition to the vilification and humiliation and massacre of Muslims around the world. But if we look deeply and broadly at what's happening here, then we see patterns and processes of criminalization are charted in the race and crime statistics across the board. So, And kind of remind us how important it is to sort of make broader anti-racist alliances, which Arzu kind of mentioned earlier, and sort of struggles against injustice. The statistics constantly show that black and Asian defendants are 20% more likely than white defendants to be given prison sentences for similar offences, that young black people are overrepresented at every stage of the criminal justice system, that they are disproportionately more likely to die in suspicious circumstances while in police custody. The legacy of the infamous sus laws, earlier preventative policing, which rose to prominence in the 1970s and 80s, disproportionately targeting young black men, continues to be evident in the disproportionate stop and search rates. So black people are 6 times more likely to be stopped and searched than whites, and only 3 times more likely to be arrested. Laws such as the Joint Enterprise Law, which is used to target gang violence, works to criminalize a whole group of people based on the actions of one individual, just unlike provisions into counterterrorism legislation permit convictions by association. So there's kind of lots of parallels between what's happening here. The scale of preemptive policing is perhaps nowhere more apparent than is the statistics on the, from the National DNA Database. In 2009, it was reported that over 3/4, 77% of young black men aged 15 to 34 are recorded on this database, which means that most young black men in this country have had some negative interaction with the police. That said, the gravity of threat that's come to be associated with the war on terror is being used to legitimate excessive state force on a scale that is unprecedented from sort of earlier times. The construction of an exceptional threat through the terrorist suspect is being used to justify exceptional measures. So the Prevent and Channel programs operate at the lower end of a spectrum of policing which criminalizes and convicts, often without evidence or due process. Many of the processes used to convict those accused of terrorism occur outside of the criminal justice system. So if we think about preemptive control orders or individuals who are deprived of their citizenship because it's deemed conducive to the public good to do so without being given specific reasons as to why, or for being tried for a criminal offence, and who are usually out of the country when this happens, giving them a little opportunity to appeal against the process. Then now we have others who are being who are having their passports removed after being assessed as Islamic extremists based on what civil court judges have termed minor suspicions, such as being late to the airport or carrying money when you're about to go on holiday. Again, this is an administrative measure, so there's no arrest, there's no charge, there's no trial, and there's no official conviction. Yet the individual affected is left without any proof of nationality, impacting on their rights to work, travel, health, education, and family life. The criminalisation of Muslims has been so effective that such measures are being passed as if appearing reasonable or without the kind of resistance that we've talked about here as being necessary. So all these measures indicate that in the war on terror we have a programme of anti-democratisation underway. The curtailment of freedom of speech, the criminalisation of dissent, the furthering thinning out of the justice system and due process. The escalating intensity of these measures means there's a more urgent need for, you know, an ever more urgent need for response, a need to suggest an alternative to what we're kind of seeing than the circularities of violence that is sort of never ending. And here I would just suggest, and this isn't just at all for, you know, the responsibility of Muslims, but that kind of alliances and solidarity across all marginalised sections of the population, refugees, asylum seekers, Muslims, black people, mobilising around the right to be recognised as human becomes ever more imperative.
That's great. Thank you very much, Nisha, for that. There'll be an opportunity again, as I said before, to ask some questions after David has also spoken. If I can reintroduce David Miller, he's a professor of sociology at the University of Bath. David is interested in understanding power, who has it, how it's exercised, and how it can be democratized. He's mostly interested in studying the powerful and is interested in a wide range of methods for doing so, including by investigative research, which he pursues with a range of collaborators. So without further ado, David.
Thanks very much. Thank you to IHRC for inviting me to speak. I'm just going to say a few things. I wanted to start with Peter, because Peter's such a lovely person, and he says such a lot of sense, and I've got such a lot of sympathy for what you say, but I want to disagree with you. And it seems to me that there's a lot in what you say about the British sense of standing up for the underdog. That, I think there's a truth in that, but there's also, of course, in British history, a lot of dark, dark things. In our colonial history, a lot of blood and torture. And you know, we tortured those people that were arrested on the 9th of August 1971 and experimented on them with the 5 techniques, which the Irish government then took the British government to the European Court, found guilty of torture, subsequently downgraded to inhuman and degrading treatment. And that experience is what the Americans drew on for Anthony Graham. They drew on that judgment and they decided that they would redefine torture in a way which was consistent with them torturing people and not calling it torture, and of course British the same thing too. So, well, I am absolutely with you on the need for democratic politics and for standing up for the underdog. British state has not always been the best example of standing up for the underdog, and I think we should recognise that, and we recognise that in the contemporary period where the current government and the previous government, the Labour government under Blair and Brown, were engaged in rendition and torture, engaged in collaboration with the Americans in torturing people, disappearing into black sites all around the world. We know that. That's all part of the counter-terrorism policy of this government. I was very pleased that you said, Arzu, that it's central to your report that the government counter-terrorism apparatus is a key element in disadvantaging Muslims. It seems to me that the government counter-terrorism apparatus is the backbone of Islamophobia in this country. We can talk about, and we should be talking about, attacks in the streets, and the person at the back talks about the person being refused service in the shop, and we should be categorising and cataloguing all that stuff, including what Nisha's been saying about the stuff which isn't according to that stats. We need to know all about that, but what pushes forward this, and which stands at the back of all this, is the government's counter-terrorism policy. including its torture around the world, but also the preventive detention stuff that happens in this country, and the statistics that Nisha has been giving us, which shows that Muslims are structurally disadvantaged in this country. And that's a form of racism, it's a form of Islamophobia. And that stands in the back of people being attacked on buses or refused service in shops. And that's the key to Islamophobia. Not people who have mad racist views on the streets, although they are the product of that set of decisions. And these are decisions taken by people who may well be urbane, witty and charming, who may well have Muslims for friends, as they might say to you, who may well not have an Islamophobic bone in their body. This is not just them saying it, that it might actually be true. These are people who take decisions which systematically and structurally disadvantage Muslims, who may not even be racists, but the effect of their action is racist, it's disadvantaging for Muslims, and that's in the back. And of course, the counterterrorism policy of the government has evolved. We saw the first iteration of PREVENT, which involved some engagement with moderate Muslim organisations. You remember the Muslim Contact Unit, which many of us worked with or had relationships with until Bob Lambert of the Contact Unit was revealed to have been involved in several undercover operations in its earlier career, which has led to that whole unit being tarnished. The transformation of the PREVENT policy from the Labour government, which involved some engagement with what we call moderate Muslim organisations, to the current iteration is quite a significant change. We saw that change with the first coalition government, with the new PREVENT policy launched after they came into power, and then again the further iteration with the counter-terrorism and security bill. Those changes have come about not just because we happen to have a Conservative government or a coalition with a Conservative government, but also because there are a whole range of elite organisations engaged in trying to push the government away from combating terrorism and combating political violence and stopping people committing attacks and towards attacking the whole Muslim community. And of course I'm referring to think tanks such as the Henry Jackson Society, on which we did a report earlier this year in June, which copies are available on our website and Spinwatch, and associated organisations. And organisations like the Henry Jackson Society and its predecessor, the Centre for Social Education, have been engaged in trying to push the government away from a risk-based approach to terrorism, which targets those engaged in political violence, and much more towards targeting non-violent extremism, as it's called, and fostering this notion of radicalisation, whereby devout Muslims can be seen as a risk to getting involved in terrorism and political violence. And of course, all the academic literature shows that there's no such relationship, that being a devout Muslim is not a marker for engaging in suicide bombing, and to think so is preposterous. But nevertheless, this is the kind of thing which has been pushed on the government by these conservative, neoconservative think tanks, which stand ready to whisper in the ears of the elite and to push the policy much more towards the deliberate all-out attack on the Muslim community in this country. We've seen that happening through the Counterterrorism Security Bill, but also through the attacks by the Charity Commission, headed by Lord Shawcross, of course, associated with the Henry Jackson Society, the attacks on 55 Muslim charities, the closing down of bank accounts of those associated with some charities like the Cordova Foundation or Page, including, and we should always remember this and pause to remember this, including the bank accounts of their children. Bank accounts of Muslim children have been closed down because they're thought to be some kind of security risk. That's a real line in the sand. When you start to do that, you start to move towards marginalising a whole community and making them, as some people said, subhuman. Now, it seems to me that it's not just the state that does that, it's also these elite social movements like the Henry Jackson Society, and they are funded by, of course, other elite organisations which are even less well-known than the Henry Jackson Society, the Conservative Foundations, some of which are, for example, run by Lord Cams, the former Conservative Treasurer, an unwell-known racist, who also is engaged, his foundation and other foundations engaged in funding illegal activities in East Jerusalem, including settlements, and you can see that there's a connection there between the kind of foundations that are funding Henry Jackson Society and neoconservative think tanks, and some conservative elements of the Zionist movement, and we should not forget that that's part of this discussion. It's not just a question of the state. It's also a question of elite social movements and think tanks which are pushing Islamophobia on the government and making things worse for Muslims in the society across the board.
Thank you very much, David, for that insightful comments and talk on this. There will be an opportunity for question and answer. I would just like, Abed, briefly just to speak about a potential solution from IHRC, or certainly on one aspect.
Okay, so I've been asked to quickly discuss our advocacy service. So since 1997, IHRC has been fighting or campaigning, researching, and on various issues, and our advocacy department has always been there in the background. Today we heard Arzu discuss our most recent work about anti-Muslim hate crime. And the work that Arzu and the team within the research team do on anti-Muslim hate crime is extremely important, and it in fact guides every aspect of our work at IHRC, not least of all our work within advocacy. Now, since 1997, we have been supporting individual victims who have been who have faced racism and anti-Muslim hate crime. So while the research gives us an idea of Islamophobia within the UK as a whole, what we have been seeing is the individual cases of Islamophobia here in the UK. And the issues we deal with are extremely diverse, from hate crimes perpetrated by neighbours to discrimination at the workplace, to within the educational field. I just want to give a couple of examples of the sorts of cases we did deal with. So there's one of the cases we dealt with was that of Yasser Abdul-Muttalib, who was a postgraduate student who was confronted by a group of youths while he was traveling to find a prayer. The young man started taunting him, calling him Bin Laden. And as they got off the bus, they basically attacked him with a stick and put him into a coma. Yasser did eventually wake up from his coma, but he suffers from disabilities as a result of the attack. He was unable to return to his studies or get back to normal life. While he was in the coma, the police investigating the attack against him also started investigating him of terrorism. Only one of his attackers received a custodial sentence, and the judge said that there was no case of religious or racial hatred to answer. Now, we supported his family throughout that whole time. We supported them, challenged the police for not prosecuting. We supported the family, challenged the NHS. So this is one of the examples of a case that we dealt with where, you know, an individual was facing anti-Muslim hate crime. Other examples include supporting an elderly lady whose house was repeatedly attacked by young men. They would damage her property and threaten her because she was Muslim. One of the things that we found, I also sort of touched on it earlier on, is within the employment field, a lot of people at the moment are having trouble challenging anti-Muslim hate crime and discrimination and racism. We've seen a drop in the number of cases within the employment field, and the reason for that is because of cutbacks in legal aid available. So what we did was, a few years ago, we set up IHRC Legal. IHRC Legal focuses on hate crimes, religious and racial discrimination within the workplace. And the idea is we provide a subsidized service for individuals who wish to bring cases against the employers where they have been discriminated against. To give you an example of a case that we worked on, so we had one client who worked for a major corporation. And right from the beginning of his employment, he was faced with ridicule and discrimination because of his faith. Colleagues used to offer him pork and alcohol with a view to sort of embarrassing him and demeaning him. His boss once asked him, "Is that a toilet brush on your face?" with regards to his beard. So we helped him challenge his employers, and he ended up with a substantial financial settlement. Our research and advocacy work go hand in hand, so we need to understand what's happening within the wider community, but we also need to challenge what is happening on the ground itself. We have been fighting an uphill battle since 1997. As the report shows, Islamophobia has now become the new normal. But we intend to continue fighting against Islamophobia and discrimination, and we hope everybody here will join us in the struggle.
Sorry, thank you very much, Robin. I would now like to open it up to the floor for brief comments and questions that people would like to ask. If you could just identify who you are, which organisation, and then the brief comment and question that you'd like to ask.
Hi,
Okay, if you'd like to...
Simon Hooper, I'm a freelancer. I was just wondering whether you could put this research in the context of other countries, particularly in Europe, because I mean, I spent a lot of time in Denmark last year, and it seemed that there was a lot of very basic problems that the Muslim communities there were facing, which they would look to the UK, and they would sort of look at the UK as a positive example. Of, like, for instance, you know, there was in Aarhus, which is the second city, they've been trying to build a mosque there for 15 years without any success. And it seemed there that, you know, there were very sort of major issues. You talked about France in the report, and you said that the situation now in the UK was akin to France. I wondered if you could comment perhaps on that.
Yes, so we have done this particular project in France as well. We're currently rerunning France and doing Germany for the first time as well with this type of question. So we can tentatively make some comparisons. Now, when we did the pilot project, we did the UK and France, and there were startling differences in terms of how Islamophobia was experienced. So, you know, there was a kind of discrete idea of being Muslim as the discourse that was being used in the UK, whereas in France you could collapse so-called discourses of ethnicity and race and religion as markers. There were differences there, but there were also differences in the type of experiences you had. What we're seeing now in the UK is a kind of move towards that environment of the discourse that you saw in France, and as we were remarking earlier before the programme started, I think, you know, I would laugh 15 years ago if I thought I'd hear the British government talking about France and saying, let's do something like France, or that's a good idea. And yet we are seeing a move towards this kind of aggressive assimilationist discourse that has kind of, if you like, always marked out a French conversation about what it means to be French, but wasn't part of the conversation that we were having for all our problems in the United Kingdom. And it's left to sort of people like us to defend the idea of multiculturalism in the UK, even though perhaps we would have been very critical of it if we had the time and the luxury. But now we're kind of just sort of in a retreat mode, trying to get people back to a conversation about some sort of plurality of pluralism. I have another point to make about France. I completely forgot what it was. If it comes back to me, I'll go to it. Denmark, we haven't done the same kind of studies. Okay, it is about looking to the UK as an example. And it's something we've been remarking upon really since the outset of IHRC and that journey I talked about at the beginning, where we came to a realisation of individuals within the organisation that actually, you know, maybe we had just got socially mobile as opposed to tried to leave problems behind as opposed to problems actually being resolved. You could argue, and many of us have, that there were certain developments in the United Kingdom, 60s, 70s, 80s, the laws, supposed shifts in culture, etc., that people in the rest of Europe could look to and say, okay, that's a way forward. Okay, and people often talked about polarisation in the Netherlands and multiculturalism in the UK as a model. Whatever the justification of that, we as ourselves in this country have been retreating from that. So it may well be that the rest of Europe can look here and go, well, it's still better over there, but the point is it's not getting better here. It is going backwards very, very fast. And I think that's the thing, that's the key facet about the UK specific experience. Whatever we had, which was good, whether we're looking back through rose-tinted glasses or not, it isn't there. We're in a completely different space, and that space is not something that we should be looking to the rest of the world to compare themselves to. There's a question from Nisha.
Question there?
My name's Sarah Kinn and I'm from Birkbeck Law School. I just wanted to make a quick comment in regards to law and strategy. Just because law's been mentioned by a number of the speakers today in regards to both hate crime law and unlawful discrimination. And I think while it's important to support people and institutions through those individual battles, it's also important to recognise the limitations of law, because both hate crime law and equality law construct racism as an aberration. And I think one of the most important things that the report does actually is show that it's not an aberration, that racism is the new normal, it's structural, and law itself is actually part of that structure, as I think David was speaking to before. So I think while it's tactically it can be important to certainly support families who've been victim of hate crime through individual cases. It's important to also retain a critical view of what we can get from law, because law itself is part of the structure that is maintaining the structure of racism.
That's great. Thank you for that comment. John?
Whilst I'm very appreciative of the work that's gone into this, and I think it's very important that we highlight these instances of racism, Islamophobia, and so on, aren't we making a mistake of maybe missing the key point? And the key point, I think, is that the government, and we're not talking about, you know, people that are not qualified, that do not know what they're doing, is actually waging an ideological, a political assault upon Islam. I mean, the question is that the moment you move away from, quite rightly, targeting violence, terrorism, and so on, and start moving into the realms of non-violence, extremism, and so on and so forth, which, as we can see very clearly from Prevent, and some of the speakers have highlighted, is actually targeting mainstream Islamic values. I mean, this is what we're seeing in our schools, we're seeing in medical practices up and down the country, and so on and so forth. So this is a demonization of the core elements of Islam, built on a ridiculous premise that the more Islamic you are, the more religious you are, whether that manifests socially, politically, and so on, the more likely that you are going to, at some point, go along some conveyor belt into terrorism, which is absolutely absurd, as David highlights, that, you know, the academic research, you know, there's nothing to support that premise. So the only thing that we can understand from this is that this is a concerted attack to say that we do not like your religion, we do not like your way of life, and we want you to adhere to some form of British Islam, or move towards something which they would define.
One more comment, and then we'll...
Got one comment and one sort of asserting something. One is that it's a sort of a movable thing. It's not fixed in terms of how Islam is viewed. There is a deeply embedded aspect, and this is a rather more movable one. For example, the Western powers in Afghanistan during the Soviet invasion funded the most extreme and fanatical aspects of the Mujahideen, because fanatics fight better. They're more prone to fight better than the other ones. So we need to take that into account. It's sort of a fixed, movable, sort of not a fixed thing, but rather movable. Now, the other thing is there's a huge amount of funding going on, particularly in the United States, on secularizing Islam all across the world. And it's a very, very highly funded, several billion dollars worth. And the ultimate aim is to make the Quran be read as a historical text and not as a divine text. So therefore, it would more be like how Western Protestant secularists would in some ways read the Bible, which is some good things in it, etc., but it's not divine, it's not from. And therefore, in some ways, it would, as the previous commentator said, really undermine the very basis of Islamic ethics and values and morality, and indeed politics. So there is that going on, more or less in all the major Muslim countries. I think that's something that one needs to say. Pinpointing, highlighting the extremists is fine, but there is this rather more insidious aspect going on in which the whole aim is to secularize the whole of that, starting with the Quran, basically. That is a very important historical text. It's something good statements to make, but it's not divine.
And thank you for those three comments. I'll open up to the panel to pick up on whichever comment they want to respond to. Nisha?
Yeah, I agree very much with both those speakers here, but I really want to make an observation and see if somebody on the panel would address it. I do think that the Prevent strategy is wrong, but and misconceived in many ways, but most British people do see that there have been acts of terror coming from inside the Muslim community. We are speaking, and nobody's really spoken about it, in the aftermath of Paris. Utter tragedy, awful. And let's put it together, of course, with Ankara, Beirut, Sinai. And I think one of the reasons, the main reason I came along today is because I know that there's something wrong about the discourse about Islam in this country. I know there is Islamophobia. But what I want to hear is how should the state, how should the media treat the problem of violence, of terrorism, which does come from within the Muslim community. And I think you need to say that, because you've got to engage with the country, the whole country. And I get a sense today that this event is very much talking to a little group. And I have some suggestions. I think Jamal was taking some of them. There is a problem of terrorism. You've got to treat it as terrorism. But I think you need to set it out in much more clearly. You've got to explain why the prevent strategy is wrong. Because so many people see there is a threat. They think the government's right to address it. And you, in that context, you have a duty, actually, not just to think we're being got at, but say, look, this is the way it should be done.
So, of course, the first way to stop terrorism is to stop committing it. And I entirely agree with Nisha. I mean, the terrorism that's being perpetrated has been perpetrated by the Western powers, by the US and the UK, in Iraq and Afghanistan and other places, should be recognised for what it is, state terrorism. And if we stop doing that, then if we hadn't gone into Iraq, there would be no Al-Qaeda or ISIS in Iraq. It's that simple. The intelligence services told the government that things would be worse if they invaded Iraq. They still invaded Iraq. We know that the kind of policies that Western governments, the UK and the US in particular, others too, including France, adopt, do not work. They do not produce the stated objectives. Remember when Bush did the aircraft carrier? Was it in April, May 2003, and said, job done? Mission accomplished, yeah. I mean, honestly, that kind of approach does not work. And we have the disaster of Paris and everything else as a direct result of Western state power. So I think that's the first thing. Stop committing terrorism. Stop bombing other countries. Stop invading other countries. Stop engaging in covert action in other countries, which results in deaths, many more civilian deaths than will be killed by ISIS in all of their existence. And we know that. It's a truth you can't speak, you can't say. That Western state terrorism causes many more deaths among civilians than does all retail terror put together. And that's based on statistics from the CIA, not from the Socialist Workers' Party. So that's the first thing. The second thing is you target at the level of threats in this country, you target crime, things that are committed or going to be committed, and we might then, from a civil liberties perspective, have things to say about how that's done, but that's a criticism about how an approach based on targeting crime and terrorism is undertaken. We had the experience in Ireland of them doing that and then trying to move away from that kind of policy and all the struggles that went on over that. You have to target actual crimes, not thought crimes, not proposed crimes, not someone with too long a beard, not someone who wears a hijab. You have to target actual crimes. And that, you know, we've moved way away from that, and including the Terrorism Act of 2000 and 2005, which introduced crimes, which are essentially crimes of the mind, thought crimes, or possession of information. Possession of information isn't a terrorist crime, it's ridiculous. But nevertheless, we have all these cases, these laws on the statute book, which result in many people going to prison, who, as one judge put it in the case of Yunus Suli, I think it was, where people have never been closer to terrorism than to a keyboard. So I think that's also part of the problem. So you target the crime. The question of a war on Islam, yes, it is, I agree with all that, but it's not just a war on Islam. The ideas that these people have who want to impose these policies, who want to target Muslims across the society, they don't just want to target Muslims. It's not an accident that so that people in prevent training or in briefings from the police are saying, of course, there's threats from the environmentalists and from the anti-frackers and from the anti-nuclear campaigners. There's threats from people who support Palestinian human rights. And that's not an accident, it's not an aberration, it's not that they just wanted to target the Muslims and somehow got it wrong. They are concerned with targeting any part of our society which can resist their power, and that means the whole of the public sector. That's partly why they've targeted the NHS and the higher education and social care for preventers, because they want to extend the methods of the intelligence services right throughout the public sector. Because the public sector stands as a living rebuke against the conservative movement. And that's what's going on here. It's not just that they hate Muslims, and many of them, as I was suggesting, are being enough not to hate Muslims. They want to pursue power and make sure that there can be no resistance against them. And that means resistance by Muslims, but also by anti-war campaigners, by anti-nuclear campaigners, by anyone who wants to pursue British values and make this a better place to live, to heighten the level of democracy, to expand the possibilities of popular control over government. It's not just the Muslims they want to get, it's all dissent.
I'm going to try and include everything, I hope, fairly. Excuse me. It's been something we've talked about for a long time, the social engineering of Islam. We have a lot of resources. We had a conference on Islamophobia last year, actually came with that title, and it's referred to here, whether it's through PREVENT or other policies, even Trojan Horse, which interacts with PREVENT, but it's sort of become a strategy of its own in education. Looks towards pushing the social engineering agenda when it comes to Islam and Islamic practice. So I don't think we are on different pages there. The gentleman who mentioned it before talks about this event as well. And I think I would just sort of use that to kind of address this idea of what it is. You said we're having a small conversation here, a talkative small conversation, but this is part of the problem of the culture that has developed, Peter. As it was, marginalised communities don't have access. There isn't that easy access. All right. Let's imagine it was all a level playing field and there weren't biases. We're still a small group. You can't have an impact, okay, in big institutions. Now let's layer into that all the issues that we've been talking about. I mentioned it before when I was introducing. We are 3 million strong or small community. That's the leadership of the sun, if that. You know, let's all make friends with the sun reader. It's still not going to change the perception of all of British society, even if we could homogenise it that way. Okay? Actually, Muslims are also part of British society. Okay? So there are problems in constructing that conversation that way. What we do need is the media, the Daily Mail, which you're now at, okay, to understand that when we talk about issues, we have to know how to speak about them. We keep constructing categories. We construct the idea of terrorism in the Muslim community. We talk about black-on-black crime. These are not actual ways of dealing with crime, as David was saying. Okay? And it's not up to members of any of these communities to come up with proper legal procedures or policing methodologies and laws, etc. It is up to institutions to do that, and to do so coming from an ethical base. And yes, we have to solve the long issues about the effects of colonial practices, the cultural underpinnings of the things that we have. But we need a recognition, and we need that space to be opened up. One of the biggest impacts of the Islamophobic environment is to silence people. People feel scared, ordinary people, in a sense, feel scared to speak out. That's one. They're endlessly, when they do speak, condemning and denouncing. Now, it's not that they don't say these things, it's that they're not heard. Why are they not heard? Because those voices are not picked up. And even when we do have a conversation about Muslims or reporting about Muslims or discussions about Muslims, it's always in that construct of terrorism or criminality. You know, we do a lot of other things. Our makeup. It's not for us to prove it, we can't prove it. It's not even possible to do that. It is up to all those institutions. So we can't open it up. It doesn't matter what we say. It is about that being opened up for us. Okay? And that requires culture shift. It requires some more leadership that we can't provide. It's not our. It's not us. We're marginalising ourselves.
There were a couple of one, two, and then Roshan, three.
Yeah, just wanted to say that.
Sorry,
I'm
name and.
Nadine Elanani, I'm also a lecturer in law at Berkeley. I just want to say that I'm quite concerned about the comments that were made by P21. And I think that aside from missing the point that David Miller illustrated, that actually the causes of terror are state violence and terror and the waging of imperial wars, but I also think that comments are themselves reproductive of Islamophobia by buying into this idea that Muslims are somehow associated with terror by virtue of me being Muslim. So I think they're quite dangerous comments. But the other thing I think they're doing in this room and in this space is distracting from a very important report and the idea that actually what we should be focusing on is the hatred that Muslims are facing today as a result of no fault of their own. And I think that the report makes those points very well. And on that point, I wanted to highlight what I think is a really important point that Arzu Merali made about how prevent this leading to the socialization of hatred. And to go back to the point that David Miller made about how to prevent YouTube being implemented differently in schools, where there isn't any, where basically it's being implemented in a much more harsh way. And what I'm worried about is children in this country growing up in schools from a very young age being constantly bullied, victimized, told they don't belong, and associated with harmful things in society that they are not to blame for. And I think that it indicates a level of victim blaming which is going to affect very seriously not only the physical health of Muslims in this country and children as they're growing up, but also their mental health. And I'm worried about the future of these young people as they grow up. I hear stories all the time of students who are bullied and victimized when they speak out, say, in support of Palestinians. And the level of bullying and victimization and referrals to the police and through prevent channels that they receive simply for speaking in class as their white counterparts do, the difference in their treatment is, I think, something that we should be really considering and worrying about the mental and physical health of young Muslims in this country today.
Yes.
From the
old
forum. My question is, I think, a simple one, but the answer, I don't know how Peter is possible to answer it. What, is there any relation, do you think, between the Zionist lobby in Europe and the increased Zionist lobby in Europe and the increase of Islamophobia? Bearing in mind that the very last conference in Herzliya, in Tel Aviv, in Israel, was about the Muslim communities in Europe, and they looked at it as a very huge threat to IS, I mean, Israeli state. Thank you.
Yeah, Roshan Ansari, I'm a journalist. I'd like Peter Oborne just to expand on the media. I know he wrote a report about 4 years ago about Islamophobia and mainstream media. Have things improved then? Obviously, Muslims are very angry about what the Daily Mail do, who you work for, and provoking Islamophobia, Daily Express, programs like Panorama. If you could just say a few words about the media and Islamophobia, that would be great. Tell Mama is a government. I mean, the people here are kind of saying that Islamophobia is a huge problem, it's coming from the government. But the government would say that they have enacted some projects, like Tell Mama, which is recording Islamophobia. They gave a lot of money to them to record Islamophobia, and the police have to record Islamophobic hate crime in England and Wales. So do you see those as positive steps? And finally, I mean, I would say that Peter Oborne, it did concern me a little bit, even though I admire a lot of the work that he does, when he kind of said they come from the Muslim community. I mean, it's like we're hiding them or something. Are we harboring these people, not telling the police about it? No, that collective responsibility is not acceptable. You can't make statements like that. But the fact is, he did hit on the point, the wider community does not seem to be listening to what we're saying. It's just not, the message isn't getting through to the mainstream media. It isn't getting through to wider society. So how do we make people listen to what we're saying?
Quite a lot of points there. Take them in reverse order. I was not suggesting there was anything like collective responsibility. And in fact I reject that entirely. I reject the idea that Muslims have to condemn the events in Paris because they're not responsible for them. I reject. There is a concern in this country a very profound concern and a justified concern about terrorism. It has suddenly become much greater in the light of the events in Ankara, in Paris, Sinai, Tunisia, you go on and you name it. Now, the reason I intervened, I didn't really mean to particularly today, but I didn't hear any reference to Paris, any serious reference to those events. I had a lot of complaints about the prevent strategy. By the way, complaints which I, in many ways, agree with. But you've got to acknowledge that there is a justified concern. In fact, it's the duty of any government to protect its citizens. And you, I think you, what I was trying to say is you've got, rather than just go on about the horror of prevent, and the unfairness and the invidiousness and the way it singles people out, I think you need to explain how the government should address the problem of terrorism in Britain today. That's what I was trying to say. Maybe I, it's quite a difficult thing to say, and I was doing my best, as though I would. As far as the media is concerned, I've done a lot of work exposing Islamophobia in the media for quite a long time, and I rather agree that it's still a, I don't know if it's getting worse, but it's certainly a real problem. I also think that sort of Islamophobic, as this report I think will argue, it argues, and you were arguing, I think the problem that Islamophobic violence and attacks and assaults is getting much, much worse. And as for the question about the Zionists and Islamophobia, I do not go in for the conspiracy theories.
So I was just going to respond to the question about Zionism. I mean, essentially, you know, it's a mistake to see Zionism as the puppet master which pulls the strings. That way is not a way we should go. Zionism is a political movement which created a state in 1948 and which continues to this day as a transnational movement. It's not able to pull the strings of Western government policy, but it is a component of Western elites. And their strategies. I mean, you can see that in the practical action of elements of the Zionist movement in this country and in America and other countries too. And it's elements of the Zionist movement, particularly the conservative elements of the Zionist movement, are aligned with neoconservatism and with the kind of push towards the conveyor belt theory and nonviolent extremism and seeing Islam as a virus which must be at least cured, if not eradicated. So that it is important to talk about those issues, but we should not see them as these issues as being created by Zionism. They're the most important elements which pushes forward these kinds of racism is the state, the British state in this country and the American state, both in terms of their activities overseas in Afghanistan and Iraq and elsewhere, but also in terms of their counter-terrorism policies in this country. So that's the most important elements which push forward practical Islamophobia on the ground. And Zionism doesn't pull the strings of that.
I'm trying to put this in a coherent train of thought. So I've heard a fair amount of people referring to Paris while I've been sitting here and how appalling that act was. I do think it's fair that we should also have been highlighting Beirut, etc., etc. It's been mentioned, and yet somehow, perhaps this is actually underlining part of the argument, that is the fact that, you know, we don't understand when we reproduce the language and the problem that we're in, which is that it doesn't matter how many times we're hearing people say what happened in Paris is appalling, it's not enough, it's not getting heard, it's not getting picked up, it's just getting thrown back as well, I'm not hearing enough. And I think with respect to Peter, I know you've done a fantastic amount of work on Islamophobia. This is something I hold myself up to be responsible for as well, which is just getting trapped in the language and conversation that we do need to break out of. Roshan asked, how do we get the mainstream media to hear this? Well, short of, I don't know, camping within the offices and trying to do an Occupy movement and forcing them to hear, I don't, which is never going to happen. I'm being flipped. Clearly my sense of humour doesn't come across, but anyway, it's not going to happen. It is about your editor and all these editors and all the people who are invested at the top levels of the media, if we're going to talk about the media, basically saying, yes, it's wrong. Okay, and I don't, you know, Gerard picked up on it earlier when he was talking about the government. I think the time of thinking that there are misunderstandings, there's just a lot of ignorance operating out there has gone. I think people in positions of power, David has spoken about, kind of elites that push certain agendas, know very well what they're doing. Okay. And where you do have that ignorance operating, it's not really an excuse anymore. We can see the effects of what's going on. We can see in places like Wembley, people being discriminated against. We can see on the London Underground, before anything happened in Paris, a woman being almost thrown, pushed under a train. Okay. And yes, we've talked about the upsurge in violence here on the streets, but it's not just about, Islamophobia is not just about those people being doing that. They are pushed to do that by the environment, and that environment pushes them here, and that environment legitimizes all these other military expeditions around the world and other interventions that, unfortunately, a lot of this violence comes out of. We are ultimately powerless communities with all our faults, okay? But we are not the ones in a position to stand up here and change things all on our own, and it's not our responsibility to do so.
Thank you.